Welcome back. It's time to take a look at the last pillar of calculus, the last of the six pillars of calculus. So to review, we start off calculus with the idea of close is good enough. Everything in calculus you do by taking limits. We learn to understand a function by seeing how quickly it changes. And we built up a gigantic technology of derivatives to see how quickly a function changes. We noticed that things that go up have to stop before they come down, and that was the basic idea of max-min. And then we learned about integration. We said the whole is the sum of the parts, and that we could get bulk quantities by breaking them up into pieces and adding up the pieces. And then we said, hey, the whole change is the sum of the partial changes. And that was the fundamental theorem of calculus. And everything we've done in this calculus class to date has involved those five pillars. But it's time to introduce the sixth pillar, one variable at a time. Whenever you're dealing with a function of more than one variable, you can get lots and lots of insight by playing with it one variable at a time. So for instance, let's suppose we're doing an experiment with DNA. Now, it turns out that the twistiness of DNA, this is exaggeration, of course, this picture, but DNA coils into these helices, and how tight the helix is depends on how salty the solution is, and it also depends on the temperature. So we can write a function. If we have some mathematical measure of how twisty it is, we might call that Z. We might call x the temperature and y the salinity, and we say that z is some function of x and y. Now, how would you go about testing what this function looks like, how this function behaves? Now, one of the very first rules you learn about experimental science is you don't just want to go in there and measure the twistiness for a particular salinity and temperature, and then go measure a completely different salinity and a completely different temperature, and then keep doing that. You want to fix one thing. You say, do all of your experiments at one temperature and different levels of salinity. Or maybe you do all your measurements with one salinity and a bunch of different temperatures. Or maybe today we'll vary the temperature and see what happens when you vary the temperature. And tomorrow we'll see what happens when we vary the salinity. But whenever you design an experiment, you never want to have lots and lots of input variables. You want to keep it simple. You want to say, we're changing this one thing, and we're seeing what the output is when we change the temperature, or when we change the salinity. Now, it's the same way in math. We're going to define something called the partial derivative. And the partial derivative, you have to say with respect to what? Here we have a function that depends on x and y. And you can define partial derivatives for functions that depend on three variables or four variables or five variables. But for now, let's suppose we have a function of x and y. The partial derivative with respect to x, which sometimes is written f sub x, the sub x means derivative with respect to x. And sometimes you write it partial f, partial x. This symbol here, the curly symbol, it's sort of like a d, but it's curly. That's the symbol for partial derivatives, and it is the same definition as an ordinary derivative, except we're holding y fixed. We're saying, what happens when you increase x by an amount h, subtract that from what you did, from what you started, divide by h, take a limit, and y comes along for a ride. Y is fixed. Likewise, the partial derivative with respect to y, you vary y, you add h to y, and you leave x fixed. You subtract off what you started, divide by h, and take a limit. So, how do you actually compute things? Well, since this was just the same as the usual definition of the derivative, you use the same rules as for the usual computation of a derivative, except that you treat y as if it's a constant, because today it is a constant. Today we're doing everything at the same salinity. We're just varying the temperature, and so the salinity is constant. Wherever it shows up in a formula, treat it like a constant. Likewise, if you want to compute the derivative with respect to y, you treat x as a constant. So let's work an example. Let's take a look at the function f of xy is e to the xy squared. If you want to figure out what fx is, you just use the chain rule. What's the derivative of e to the something? It's e to the something times the derivative of that something. And in this case, since y is a constant, the derivative of a constant times x with respect to x is just that constant. So I would probably write that as y squared e to the xy squared. And if you wanted to figure out the derivative with respect to y, you would say, well, that's e to the xy squared times the derivative of xy squared with respect to y. And now we're treating x as if it's a constant. The derivative of a constant times y squared is that constant times 2y. So we get 2xy e to the xy squared. All we're doing is we're taking a derivative the usual way. You know how to take a derivative of e to the 3y squared with respect to y, or e to the 7y squared with respect to y. We're just taking the derivative of e to the xy squared with respect to y, where x is just a constant. Okay? Now, the same thing works if you had more variables. If you have a function of three variables, well, you see what happens when you vary x and you leave y and z alone. So you take a derivative with respect to x, treating y and z as constants. And of course, that gives us the cosine of xy plus z squared times, well, the derivative of this with respect to x is just y. And fy is cosine of xy plus z squared times the derivative of xy plus z squared. Well, let's see, constant times y plus constant squared. Derivative of that is just the first constant. And f sub z the derivative of this, well, this is a constant. Derivative of that is 0. Derivative of z squared is 2z. So that's how you take partial derivatives. In the next video, we'll start to talk about what the partial derivatives actually tell you about a function.